Depending on your habits, the code you write in C# might be more or less functional. This interface is, by all means, functional, but it is written in an object-oriented style. It is both object-oriented and functional. I will now show you how that works, as well as the issues that it may cause. How would you instantiate that interface in some completely different portion of code? What concrete types implement it? That is easy. Put the cursor over the type name and press the keyboard shortcut in your IDE. There you have them. This interface defines a potentially incomplete date. Concrete implementations include a full date, a year, or a year with a month. The names are so clear. These types are descriptive enough for anyone to figure out that this event will occur sometime during May 2025. Then we start using the object. We only have what the interface offers. For example, this is the date by which other business processes must end. I'm sure this will be May the 1st. I don't have to check. The code is self-evident so far. Conversely, the results will be available after this date. Some people make object-oriented programming look complicated, but don't be some people. Object-oriented programming can be so beautifully simple and natural. But not always. This is a different portion of my code. This class is the type converter required to persist those incomplete dates using Entity Framework Core. The converter is also consuming that interface. We convert an incomplete date to an int, substituting zeros for the missing components. Converting in the other direction goes by checking which components of the date are missing in that integer encoding. The conversion method is instantiating the appropriate concrete class. These two methods show a tragic shortcoming of the original object-oriented programming. How do I know this branch will never happen? To avoid such surprises, we must define the conversion on the interface. Both these methods would therefore move close to the interface. The interface would mandate conversion to an integer. That immediately starts causing massive troubles for the interface. The interface now depends on the type used in a different application layer. Today it is an int, so we might not pay attention. Tomorrow it could be a document type required for some NoSQL storage. The model now depends on storage. Did you see that coming? How about adapting to the UI layer? How about having multiple views of the same domain model? Everything depends on everything else now. Large projects of the past were ridden with issues of this kind. That was around the time when the single responsibility principle was first formulated. Each layer would add a few methods to the model to satisfy its own needs. That would let us remove all those ephemeral responsibilities from the model. That, however, requires public property getters. Fast forward 20 years to the present day, and here we are using read-only properties on immutable objects all around. That is what made this interface functional. The interface is screaming immutability. Can you imagine a concrete implementation that mutates the object when I call a method on it? If I made a mutable implementation here, oh, that would be the most unpleasant surprise. My friends who use that interface would eventually report a bug. So to return to the question from the title, how far is your object-oriented code from immutable design? You must be pretty close already if you have developed a habit of designing small immutable classes, but you can do much more. A few other interfaces define immutable classes in this design. They all end up as parts of this mutable class which models a book release. Immutability must end somewhere if you wish to use Entity Framework Core. It tracks changes to entity objects, so entities must be mutable to use it. Still, parts of entity classes can be immutable. The addition is immutable. This representation is there for the database mapping. It is immutable. The publication information is entirely immutable and may incorporate that partial date interface you saw, which is also immutable. Almost everything inside the entity is immutable, yet the entity itself mutates as the application uses it. That is quite normal and also fully supported by Entity Framework Core. You can configure the immutable parts of a mutable entity. Watch other videos on my channel where I have demonstrated the mapping capabilities of EF Core configuration. Here is just a short story. This is the configuration of the book entity which, among other parts, contains a release object as a complex property. Properties of a complex property end up stored in the same table alongside the entity's own properties. Then there comes the configuration of the releases properties, which are plenty and some of them fairly complex too. The publication info is a functional type which implies it is deeply immutable. It is inside this type's configuration that we find that type converter, which encodes a partial date into an int back and forth. Free calls into depth from the closest entity, we find some functional mapping at last. This method literally attaches behavior to iPartialDate without modifying the interface. A user interface layer would do the same, defining conversion to and from JSON, for example. However, I have already pointed out the problem with adding functional concept to an object-oriented type this way. Nobody can guarantee that these three variants are all implementations of the interface. That is the whole point of an interface. It is open-ended. Are you ready to take the last step, which will turn all those immutable interfaces into proper functional types? Let's begin with the transformation now. Please note that you can download the entire source code before and after the change from my Patreon page. Every registered patron is helping hundreds of other fellow programmers watch all the videos on my channel for free. So please join me and help me keep this channel free for everyone else. All the links are in the description. First, interfaces play no role in functional design. Functional code attains polymorphism in an entirely different way. You will see that in a minute. Behavior does not belong with the type definition either. We define behavior separate from the types in functional design. Also, we shall not use virtual methods in functional design. The type becomes nothing but a record. We implement polymorphic types in functional design via discriminated unions. Discriminated unions are coming to C#, so you better get used to them. While we are still waiting for the native syntax, we can use an abstract base record and then list the variants as sealed records inheriting from it. One variant is the full date, which encapsulates the date-only instance. Another variant is the year plus the month number. The third and the last possible variant is just the year number. The difference compared to an interface is that the story ends here. There will never be another variant unless added right here. As of now, that still depends on the coding discipline. Proper discriminated unions will bring compile time assurance that no other subtypes can exist. Then come the consequences. All properties are now read-only and public. We also had that with the interface, but we could not know whether some concrete class would add a private property. That would make EF Core configuration much more convoluted. Whatever a functional type has to say, it says it publicly. Then comes the behavior defined on a discriminated union. A common way to simulate a discriminated union with common records is to introduce an extension method that maps one union as a whole. Request free mapping functions, one per variant, and thus ensure that all the angles are covered. Capture each variant in isolation, then apply the corresponding mapping function. There will still be the catch-all hand here because of the switch expression, only this time will it indicate a bug, not an intention. The discriminated union syntax will make extension methods like this one obsolete. This is all we need to produce a value from any partial date, no matter which layer we need it in. It is common in functional C# to attach extension methods to a functional type. This extension method will return the beginning of an interval defined by a partial date. Each method would have the same form, though. Call the map extension method on the object, provide mapping for each variant alone, you're done. How about calculating the following date range? It is easy, I told you that every function will have the same structure. The third function we had was the one that calculates the last date belonging to a date range. Here it is, as simple as any other. This completes re-implementing the three concrete classes that used to implement that interface. Besides putting it all into one place, I haven't accomplished much. I will surely delete that entire subnamespace, but now I need to explain the real benefits of having a proper functional type. There are three types with three functions defined on each. We had that with the object-oriented model already. The difference is that the object-oriented model would attract more methods as it matures. To begin with, it required mapping to database types and to UI types. Any new feature would end up defined on the interface. That inflation would never stop. The functional model expressly puts that burden into the hands of the one who needs it, typically another layer or another vertical slice. This is how it does it. It says, I give you all the components publicly. There is nothing more than what you see here. There is nothing hidden in the objects. I also give you the universal method to map the entire type into whatever type T you wish to have. Is that some database type? I don't want to know. Is that some UI document type? I don't want to depend on it. No matter how much more code I might write regarding the partial dates in this application in the following decade, this file will stay unchanged forever. Object-oriented design could not warrant that. That value converter is asking for help. Let's help it out. Map the partial date into an int, and the EF core will catch up from there. As you can see, the Entity Framework core will keep supporting functional types natively when they are part of an entity it tracks. It is capable of tracking records already. In the final version of this application, which you can download from my Patreon page, I have turned the Publication Information interface into another functional type. Even the Books edition is now a functional type. Everything that is not an entity is now a record. That means that all the mappings to and from the database types in the application are now defined in the persistence layer, and all the mappings to and from JSON are defined in the UI layer. You get a natural separation of concerns for free when you turn all small immutable types into functional types. The same separation is far from ideal in an object-oriented design based on interfaces and concrete immutable classes.